Good morning, everybody. As we gather for worship, the prelude is Triumphal Processional.
Thank you. two, three. Might be a little bouncy, yeah. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to be with you all as we gather for worship on this third Sunday of Easter. We continue, I've been keeping tabs. I know things, the rate of infection is beginning to rise again over the last week or so. We continue, according to the paper, as a county to be in the low phase. So at this point, we will continue to offer the sacrament of Holy Communion as we have been. Those who are comfortable doing so may come forward to receive the wine or grape juice and wafer. For those who are not comfortable there are communion cups front and back, which you're welcome to use, and you can, if you have not picked one up, you can pick one up anytime during our worship this morning. Through the Easter season, following our regular offering, we will be receiving jingle offering for the benefit of the Potato Project, a project that provides potatoes and other vegetables to the food bank here in Berks County and Schuylkill County, and I think even down into Montgomery County. So we'll be coming around. We have little metal buckets which will be used for that receiving or that particular offering for those who wish to make that contribution. And then our activity sheets, upcoming announcement for upcoming events, back on the back table. Please pick one up as you depart worship this morning if you have not already gotten one. Following worship this morning, there will be a brief cottage meeting. It's kind of a makeup meeting. I know lives are busy and some people are not able to make cottage meetings that they were assigned to attend. If that's the case, or if you wish to attend to get a better handle on the capital campaign we are now engaged in, please feel free to come downstairs to the fellowship hall, and that will take probably about an hour following worship, and then you can be on your way. Reminder, don't forget, May 15th, we are having a special staff recognition Sunday. There are two members of our staff that have reached a significant milestone in their service with us. Seth has been here 10 years, and Bruce is approaching his 15th anniversary this month as our director of music. So, for those two, and then for Lisa, who was finally able to retire this year, after hoping to do so at some point last year, we will be having a special brunch and celebration recognizing their service to our congregation and Lisa's retirement from that service, although she's still here and continuing to help our new administrative assistant segue into her position much more smoothly. You cost for the brunch is $10 per adult and $5 per child ages 3 to 11. And if you've misplaced your form, you can call and let us know. You can just leave an envelope with the money in for that as you wish. There are also two sign-up sheets out in in the narthex by the offices. There is a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board to garner desserts for the staff recognition event. We decided not to include dessert in the pricing and felt we could get some volunteers and we'd have a variety of desserts. So that is on the bulletin board. We need folks to sign up for that. And then Seth has scheduled a May 22nd mixer event like we had back in, I believe, February, early February, late January. And there is a sign-up sheet for that on the main office door. There will be a potluck luncheon involved with that event. So please take time to look at those sign-up sheets and be sure you're signing up for what you want to sign up for out there on those two sheets. And where is Seth today? Seth is down in Philadelphia with four of our youth, and Meredith Mace is also with the group as a chaperone, and they are working on projects in as part of the Philadelphia Project. It's a ministry developed in the Philadelphia area to patterned after the Pittsburgh Project, which Seth has taken youth on in past years. Well, this is just over the weekend. They've been down since Friday evening, and they are working with low-income families on some housing needs and so forth down there during this weekend.
Seth and Will did insulation.
I'll let you fill them in. I didn't know that.
Yeah, two of my kids are on the project, and Kendall texted me last night. Seth and Will installed insulation yesterday. Kendall and Meredith did cementing. And Emily and Gabby, the two other girls, picked up trash and did some other things. So that's what they were doing.
Yay. And I am sure they will share that with all of you in their inimitable way when they return. So, but that's awesome. They come back later today, this evening, as far as I know, right?
This afternoon.
Yeah. Any other announcements for the good of our community this morning? Yes, Dan. Yes, Rita. Very good. I see David. I have to tell you, I didn't get to talk to you yet. The high school concert the other night was one of the finest high school concerts from singing to playing that I've heard in years. Really fantastic. Our young people, young musicians, did a great job. It really was. I was so proud of them. And middle school, Andrew, middle school happens when? Next Wednesday, okay. A week and a half from now. Very good. And elementary is the 19th? 19th, that's right. You told me that, 19th this morning. So we'll get to hear our budding musicians as they grow into that high school program along the way. So great. All right, any other items for the good of our community this morning?
Let's say hi to Terry and Rita. Welcome back among us in person.
Yep, back from Florida, very good. All right, I want to take this time again to thank Bruce and our choir for their worship leadership. Louise, thank you for being our assisting minister this morning. Alicia, you're serving as lector, right? Okay, I remembered seeing that. And Andrew and Brandon are making the technology work for us this morning. Closed captioning is available for those who are in virtual land with us this morning, streaming land. So you may use that if you so desire. Let us continue with our worship this morning. Please rise. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
In the waters of baptism, we have passed over the death from death to life with Jesus Christ, and we are a new creation. For this saving ministry and for this water, let us bless God, who was, who is, and who is to come. We thank you, God, for your river of life flowing freely from your throne, through the earth, through the city, through every living thing. You rescued Noah and his family from the flood. You opened wide the sea for the Israelites. Now, in these waters, you flood us with mercy, and our sin is drowned forever. You open the gate of righteousness, and we pass safely through. In Jesus Christ, you calm and trouble the waters. You nourish us and enclose us in safety. You call us forth and send us out. In lush and barren places, you are with us. You have become our salvation. Now breathe upon this water and awaken your church once more. Claim us again as your beloved and holy people. Quench our thirst, cleanse our hearts, wipe away every tear. To you, our beginning and our end, our shepherd and lamb, be honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving, now and forever. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Living Lord, you meet us in unexpected places and surprise us with the abundance of your love. Feed us by your word and fill us with your spirit so that we may follow you this day and always. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading today comes from Acts chapter 9. Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly, a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, "He is the Son of God." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading today comes from, Okay. The second reading today comes from Revelation chapter 5. "Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice, 'Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing.' Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, 'To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever.' And the four living creatures said, 'Amen,' and the elders fell down and worshiped." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel comes into our midst this day in the 21st chapter of John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I'm going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You know what I have here? A fishing rod. How many of you are fishermen or women? All right. Sadly, I have not been. I have drowned a few worms in my life and gone deep sea fishing on a few times, but have not much to show for it. In fact, those deep sea fishing trips were group trips, and the only reason I had fish to bring home was other people caught those fish. Today we get a fishing story. Scholars think that this was an add-on chapter, that there were some unfinished questions about Jesus' resurrection that were circulating around the Johannine community where this gospel was first offered as a story about the life of Jesus. And some of those questions are attempted to be answered in the gospel we have for our reading this morning. And were probably added perhaps by a disciple of John, somewhat similar in voice to the gospel, but were not written by John as part of the original gospel. Be that as it may, it's an important story because in this story, Peter finds redemption. Do you see that in the pattern of the story? Jesus asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" Why would he do three times ask that question?
Because he thinks Peter because Peter said, "I do not know the man," three times. Do you remember that? Just a few nights before, most likely. And it is in this time that Peter finds and is redeemed, is brought back into the community of faith as a trusted leader, the leader Jesus intends him to be in the growth of the church over the coming years. It's an important story for that, but it's also important about this fishing piece. The men in that boat went back to doing what was normal for them to do, to fish. But Jesus says, you're going to have a different task because I'm going to make you fishers of people. You're going to go out and bring people into the ship of faith, if you will, into the church, to the community of faith. And you will grow this community by your going out and inviting others in. This morning, we have the great joy of receiving some new members here at Trinity. And we can grow. Believe me, there are many in this community who want to hear and probably need to hear the good news that God loves them and has redeemed them through the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I may not be a good fisherman of fish, but hopefully God will give me the ability to be a good fisher of men and women, of those who have the opportunity to invite others to join this community of faith and serve their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I trust that you will. In fact, God promises us that we can all be good fishers of his children. Amen. Let us pray. God, grant us courage and strength to go out into your community and in our places of work, of school, wherever we may find ourselves. Give us the courage to share the love that we know you have for us and for all your children and for this creation. Amen. All right. I apologize, I didn't have water ready this morning. It was a busy early morning here at the church and I didn't get the water in for the font. So I will get back to doing that next week. You take a week off and it's amazing what slips by you. I guess it's something to do with being 70 years old too, maybe, I don't know. Have you ever been unable to see another person's viewpoint? Just tried, but no matter how hard you tried, it just seemed so foreign to what you held as important. I have certainly experienced that. Things that I'm passionate about in particular can be hard for me to move off that passionate view, to be more open and understanding as to other possibilities that often exist. One such time occurred for me just a little over a year ago. Well, actually, about a year ago, right around this time. It started in the month of April at a school board meeting. A group of citizens concerned about some things that had been disseminated at school and the way that was done, showed up at a school board meeting. And they were upset, and they pointed their finger at a policy our board had approved back in the late summer, early fall of the year before, kind of in the midst of the pandemic. An action we thought was not particularly controversial because it was a policy which put educational equity at the forefront of our district. But they were upset because both how that policy was being instituted, established in our district, and about the policy itself. I was nonplussed and maybe even a little angry in the early go, because it was taking immense amount of time. A speaker would get up, and board meetings that maybe ran 45 minutes to an hour were now running to 11, even 12 o'clock at night. And then on one occasion, I was out in the parking lot till 1 o'clock in the morning. As my wife shakes her head, yes. Talking with folks who were on the opposite side of where I was, and many on the board were. It finally made me go back and look at the policy we had approved that year earlier. And I began to see some things in the policy that didn't seem to quite fit what we wanted to accomplish. And so I began to work with the policy a bit and made some revisions. And in the process of that, of course, this group continued to come to board meetings and to raise their concerns. And a few weeks into this whole endeavor, I received an invitation from a citizen in the community who at that point I did not know, but came to know that she kind of had friends on both sides of the issue. And she invited me to sit down with them. We gathered up at Kutztown Park one evening after dinner and to talk. And while I didn't fully agree with what they proposed or where they were coming from, because primarily, their proposal was get rid of the policy, I believed there was room to find some common ground and we could work together to do that. And we did. We began it that night. And it continued over the coming months as we heard things. Folks on the board began to join me, some of them, to work on some of the wording and to think about this in a different way to maybe bring about greater clarity regarding the policy and to address some of the concerns that were being raised by those who opposed it. Seeing another point of view can be difficult, especially when you feel passionate or zealous about a particular approach or item and an understanding of something. And that certainly is the case for Saul in our first lesson this morning that Alicia read just a few minutes ago. This is Saul, who will become the Apostle Paul, we're told in the 13th chapter of the book of Acts. So we understand who we're talking about this morning. Saul was a zealous Jew who loved God with all his heart, so much so that he sought to protect his faith from any perceived enemies, internally or externally. And as he understood it from his point of view and from the point of view in which he was raised, the way that group of people that were followers of this Jesus, this rabbi, Jesus of Nazareth, were becoming a threat to the faith that he held so dear and for which he was indeed zealous. And so he seeks permission from the high priest to go to the synagogues in Damascus and to extricate those members of the way and to bring them back to Jerusalem to stand judgment. However, on the way to Damascus, he encounters an epiphany, an experience of faith and of God. And in this bright and shining light moment that indeed blinds him temporarily, he comes to see a new reality. As he hears a disembodied voice from the heavens saying to him, "Why do you persecute me?" And he finds out that the voice is none other than the voice of the ascended Jesus, God's only Son. Indeed, God. We're told he goes on to Damascus, this time led by those who are with him, because he has become blind, unable to see. The light has blinded him. The presence of God has blinded his seemingly clear vision of things. And he spends 3 days in Damascus in prayer and fasting. Doesn't take any water or food during that time, we're told. And in the meantime, God is at work in another person, Ananias, whom he asked to go to this Saul of Tarsus and to talk with him and to let him know what God desires of him. At first, Ananias is hesitant to do that and protests. He's sort of wants to remind God, do you know what he's done? Do you know what he was coming here to do? Do you understand? And God says, yes, don't worry. I have a purpose for him, and he will change. And so he does, because he becomes one of the most fierce defenders of the faith and prolific evangelists the church has ever known. Saul was certain he knew what God desired of him, but in a flash of light, that certainty faded away. And he came to understand that God was doing a new thing through this Jesus of Nazareth. It wasn't easy, this change in Paul. Caused him to become blind. Transformational change often isn't very comfortable or easy. Last spring and summer and into the fall were not easy times in my life or in the life of those who served on the board of school directors at that point in time in this district, as well as other districts. This wasn't only a novelty here in Kutztown. It wasn't easy. Most transformational experiences, I know those I've been through, haven't been easy ones either, because they cause you to rethink what you have counted on as certain. But through this process, Paul came to understand what the prophet Isaiah once said, when he reminded his hearers in those days that God's thoughts are not our thoughts, and God's ways are not our ways. And we know that Paul's life was changed to the core, because in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, that great passage or chapter on love, Paul concludes with these words, "Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known." So you and I can know only in part in this life, and we need to keep our eyes open and our hearts open to the leading of God in this wonderful journey of faith that we are engaged in. Who knows what God desires of us? Even as Saul, we may find a life-changing moment that God will call us, in which God will call us to a new life and new understanding of his grace and love. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Joining our fellowship this morning to come forward at this time. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for these sisters and brothers whom you have made your own by water and the word in baptism. You have called them to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ.
Amen.
I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the Church. Do you believe in God the Father? Let us all join together in the responses. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You have made public profession of your faith. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people, following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If so, answer each in turn, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. People of God, do you promise to support these sisters and brothers and pray for them in their life in Christ? If so, answer, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit, you give us new birth, cleanse us from sin, and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in your people the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever.
Amen.
All right, we're going to ask you to turn around, and we'll come out in front of them for a moment. And
let us rejoice with these sisters and brothers in Christ.
We rejoice with
you. Life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. Introduce to you Jessica. She works in the retail field in human resources. And these two strapping young men here are twins. And this is Elijah. And this is Liam. Okay? And I learned a good clue. Their hair parts on different sides, and Liam's parts and combs over to the left. So my wife highlighted that for me a couple weeks ago when we were together at Easter breakfast. So that's how I'm remembering the name so well. Jeremy works at St. Luke's Hospital in the IT field. Rebecca Gilligan is teaching right now at El Tri-C. This is her last semester doing that, because part-time. She also works for a pharmaceutical company that provides some of the ingredients that we need for the medications I probably take, and probably several of us take maybe here in the congregation. But aside from that, she has got a wonderful goal. She's going to be heading to KU in the fall to earn her master's in education and to teach new generations of children coming along the sciences. So So particularly, I suspect, biology, right? Yeah. Okay, let us welcome them. And they got an expression of our welcome and love in a bag that was provided by Debbie Ziegler and the Worship Life team. So we're looking forward to their participation in the life of our community. Welcome. You may return to your seats. And you can remain seated as soon as I get here to the prayers. We'll move forward with our prayers. Let us pray. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, people in need, and all of creation.
Holy One of new beginnings, fill us with new life. Send us into the world as you sent your apostles Philip and James to invite people to come to see your wondrous acts in Christ. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Revive ecosystems along coastlands that have been devastated by natural forces and human negligence. Reestablish plant and animal life that purifies our air and water. Empower us to protect the plant and animal life that feeds humans and every other living creatures. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Accompany laborers who get little rest from their work. Give them hope when they struggle to provide adequately for their families or themselves. Give all who labor fair treatment and just wages. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Restore all people who cry to you for help, especially
Kathy, Sherwood and Jean, Gail, Deb, Kenneth, Ray, Missy, Bo, David, Missa, Betty, Jenny, Libby, Gary, Ed, Jimmy, Walt, Jan, Bob, Joe, Christine, Warren, Bob, Steve, the family of Annabelle Fisher.
Turn their mourning into dancing. Clothe them with joy. Bring healing to their body, mind, and spirit. And may your praise be forever upon their lips. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Be present to faithful ones who are persecuted for following you. Sustain them by your faithfulness and give them strength in the name of Jesus. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Join our voices with angels, creatures, and all the saints in praising Christ and bestowing upon him all blessings and honor and glory. Reveal Christ's glory to us and through us in our worship. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Rejoicing God, bless those who have reason to celebrate in these days and help us rejoice with them on the occasion of their birthdays, especially Stephen Esser, Justin Turk, Brenda Loeb, Samuel Esser, Elena Raffi, Clark Kramer, William Ziegler, Megan Hoffman, and Ed Rakowicki. God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And now the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share the peace of our Lord as safely as you are comfortable doing. Peace be with you.
Thank you. Peace be with you, everybody.
It's 10:30.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Living God, you gather the wolf and the lamb to feed together in your peaceable reign, and you welcome all at your table. Reach out to us through this meal and show us your wounded and risen body, that we may be nourished and believe in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should, at all times and in all places, give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, the God of power and might,
and full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, in mercy for our fallen world. You gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper.
Amen.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. For those who are at home and or at the pews and wish to receive communion there, we will do so now. You can take the wafer, the body of Christ given for you. And if you are ready with the wine or grape juice rather, you can free that and the blood of Christ shed for you. And now those who wish to come forward, the wine will be to my right and grape juice alternative will be to my left. And there are gluten-free wafers if you so wish. Oh, that's mine. I need that. There you go. Yes. And method of reception is through intinction. If you wish to hold that, if you need to wipe anything. Okay.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Sorry. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, generous God, for in this bread and cup we have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives all may know life in Jesus' name. Amen. And now God, the author of life, Christ, the living cornerstone, and the life-giving spirit of adoption, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Go in peace. Tell what God has done.
Thanks be to God.
Don't forget, those who would like to join downstairs for the cottage meeting that's going to be here at the church right after worship here, you are welcome to do so. For additional information regarding the capital campaign we are now engaged in.